Hey, what's going on, Brawlhalla?
What is up?
We've got a special guest today. I'm TWK.
I am Starlight from Threes Up.
Oh yeah, we've got him here today. Fota is up at PAX East. There's definitely going to be a lot of stuff going down there, so keep an eye out. But we've got a tournament going on down here this weekend.
Indeed, and that is why I'm here on the stream today, is because I will be here for Final Round 20.
Yes. Yeah, Atlanta's premier fighting game tournament. You know, we are there this year. We were there last year. You said you were...
I was there last year as well. It was pretty fun.
Yeah, so how did that go?
So there was... Egg Soup came. I went, and then there was like a bunch of just people from the tournament that were like, oh, it's a free-to-play game. Free to sign up. Let's try for this $1,000. And then they were all... and then everyone that I fought's like, oh, wow. This game's pretty deep.
Oh, so, yeah.
And then, we went to Grand Finals, me and Egg Soup, obviously. Actually, Noel was here.
Yeah,
he was here.
One of the first times he was playing the game, right?
He played, like, he was probably, like, gold back then.
Oh
I don't know.
Oh, my gosh. Like, the birth of Noel.
Yeah, and now look at him. He's insanely good.
Monster. So. I mean, I'm assuming he's going to be here this weekend.
Yeah.
Well, he's local to Atlanta, you know, we see him all the time. But is that who you're looking at as, like, your main competition this time around?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it will be Noel and I in Grand Finals, probably, since I don't think anyone else notable is really traveling for this, so we'll see.
I mean,
all the other local Atlanta talent might come out, and we'll see.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Mm-hmm. I mean, we've been seeing them all at Fota Fridays. You know, we all get together and play. I think Baboot's coming through.
Oh, yeah,
Baboot. Yeah, he's good.
Mm-hmm. I met him last year. He's really nice. Can't wait to meet him again.
Really cool guys. So, I'm excited that you're here. You know, we get to hang out again, because I haven't seen you in person since BCX.
Since November, I mean, like, it's been a while. Yeah,
it has been a while. So, I'm sure a lot of these folks who are watching, you know, they're the esports fans. We've got Brawlhalla fans in the house. What have you been up to since BCX? I know we saw a lot of you playing there. You made top 8 in 1v1. You won 2v2s. Mm-hmm. So, what have you been doing? What's the news for Starlight?
So, right now, it was kind of an off-season after BCX. We just had the biggest tournament ever, $50,000, right?
Yep.
There's no need for any big tournaments that happen yet. But we got the Winter Championship, which was January?
Yep, that was, I think it was the first weekend of February.
Oh, February, yeah. Okay. So, we had that. I was just basically prepping myself, making sure I was staying relevant, because I took a break from the game after that. I was like, all right, so I won this... I'm pretty happy with my performance. Let's focus on college. Let's focus on other games that seem fun. Let's just take a bit of a break. And it helped me, I think. I think, like, I came back stronger after a break, because before that I was playing like 8 to 9 hours a day just practicing for BCX.
Oh yeah, that's brutal.
While going to college, like, I'd come home from college at like some days at like 4, and then I'd stay up till about like 1 or 2 a.m. playing Brawlhalla to practice, right? Because especially since I teamed with Daiku at Worlds, he contacted me like a week before, and he's like, hey, do you want a team for Worlds? I'm like, sure, let's go for it, because I had no one at that point. So,
I mean, that was not the first time that you two have played together, though. Because, you know, before all the glitz and glam, these sponsors getting in, during the old days, it was kind of like your quest to join a specific team, right? And that's kind of where you met Daiku for the first time?
Kinda. Yeah, but I don't know what made him approach me. I know Dobrain couldn't go, so maybe that's why. But he approached me, we practiced for that, we practiced so much for that 1 week. We did a lot of stuff. We did some replays, focusing on like LDZ and stuff like that. And then we're like, all right, let's go into it. And honestly, when we got to Atlanta, we met each other for the first time, right? It was pretty awkward, but pretty amazing. So But
I always enjoyed that, you know, just meeting everyone in person for the first time for a lot of these folks. You know, I'd met you before up at Combo Breaker in Chicago.
Yeah.
But, you know, a lot of players, they come by, oh, my God, it's great to meet you. You know, I'm so-and-so. And it's just putting that name to a face.
Name to a face. Is this such a surreal experience, you know? But we met him, right? Instead of hanging out, because everyone came there Thursday, I had to be there Friday. So we had like one night before the tournament. So everyone else is hanging out, going to get dinner, doing whatever they were doing. Daiku and I just sat in our hotel room and practiced. Just practiced for until late at night. And then we got up, did our pools, and then we were good. But we, instead of hanging out with everyone, we just like decided to practice instead. So I missed a lot of the social aspect of BCX, but
oh, okay, yep.
We won.
You were there to compete. You were there to train in the series.
Yeah.
Yeah, I do know you got to take a lot of photos with everyone. I saw you going around with your trophy, you know.
Yeah, gotta show off.
Yep, that's how it goes, you know. So, I imagine your sponsor has to be pretty pleased with your performance so far.
Yeah.
And your standings in the circuit this year.
Mm-hmm. We're doing pretty well so far. I had a pretty shaky performance in 1v1s in Winter Championship. Mm. Like, I lost to Steve. And I don't
Steve
normally lose.
Steve's going on a tear, though.
Yeah, he played really well, so I can't really blame him. But normally that's not someone I lose to, so I was kind of sad. I think I placed, like, fifth or something. And that, honestly, if you look back, the lowest I've ever placed in a BCS 1v1, like the $1,000 circuit weekly thing, I placed fourth, and that happened once. Every other time was either third, second, or first. So it's like, placing fifth just like a huge hit to my mentality.
Wow.
So, but we brought it back. We got second in 2v2s, so I was pretty happy about that.
I mean, those are very consistent results. Mm-hmm. So, you know what? I know there are a lot of players, and we do get these questions all the time. I know Photo's constantly getting them, Raven as well. A lot of players looking for a sponsor.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, you were picked up by you know...
Oh.
Let's see what we've got here, if this is on there. Yes. So we know you got picked up by Threes Up,
mm-hmm.
and I saw you rocking that jersey at BCX, and you know
I love their jerseys so much.
You've been putting your Threes Up all the time for the sponsor. So how did that kind of go about?
All right, so I met someone early on. I'm probably the only top player who actively looks for these. I go out. I made a portfolio of all my tournament placings. I put VODs there. I put links to the brackets. I put my total amount of money earned. I put all the calculations in there. I put all that together. And then I emailed. I just emailed everyone. I emailed everyone I could find. See who would talk back with me. And no one else does that. They just put, oh, contact this email for business inquiries in their Twitter. And they expect things to happen. And it's like, that's not how it works. So I actively looked. And then
okay.
Threes Up gave me the best offer, so I'm like, let's go with them.
So it was a lot of just putting it out there, mm-hmm. contacting them, kind of, I guess, marketing yourself.
Marketing
myself.
And
what you could bring to their brand. Okay.
Definitely. But I met someone named Shark. He's actually playing in... He played in the Winter Championship and stuff. He's playing in block qualifiers and everything now. So he's pretty into the game, but... He has connections to a lot of these organizations, and he actually works for Threes Up as like their social media person. Nice. So I had that opportunity as well to get with them because of his connection through me helping me out. So in the end, I kind of just went with them because I was Shark mostly, but that's how it goes. That's how it goes.
That's cool, man. Well, it's been going great. I always love watching you play. I love seeing, you know, the performance, and you stream a lot yourself as
well,
right? Yeah,
I do stream pretty much every day. Like, I'm a college student. I go to classes until, like, from, like, 9 to 4. But after that, if I'm not too tired, I pretty much stream every day. Yeah.
Wow, awesome. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I've been seeing you play a lot of Brawlhalla, but not just Brawlhalla. You do bounce around to other things as well.
So
always with a competitive nature,
though, right? Yes, only competitive games. I'm such a competitive person. Every game I play, there has to be some type of competition to it, or else I don't enjoy it. Like, I guess single-player games like Assassin's Creed, those are cool, but I just can't enjoy it as nearly as much as a competitive game. But recently, I don't know, Brawlhalla has been cool. Like, I love having like all the viewers and everyone supporting my stream, but like, I just want to be like a variety streamer, you know? I don't always want to play Brawlhalla. I want to play Overwatch. I want to play Dead by Daylight. I want to play all these other games, but no one watches me. After I switch off Brawlhalla, I get like 10 viewers, and it sucks, but
okay, so
that's what I want to do, you know? Like, if they're not here for, they're here for Brawlhalla, then whatever, they can leave. It's fine.
Wow. All right. Well, you know, I mean, that's you know, kind of breaking out into new spaces and things like that. So it's not uncommon or unlike, you know, when you were looking for a sponsor.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of like just constantly putting yourself out there.
Yeah, definitely.
That's really just what we're looking for.
Mm-hmm.
Now, today, I know you were kind of saying you wanted a little bit of warm-up for the tournament.
Warm-up for the tournament.
You know.
Let's
go. So you were... you know, putting yourself out there for the sponsor, but you're going to put yourself out there for competitors.
Competitors.
So we're going to get an open lobby set up and go ahead.
I want to set up my controls really
fast. Oh, he's going to set up his controls. We're going to get an open lobby. You know how we usually do these Play a Pro setups on the Friday dev stream? Mm-hmm. Well, we actually have him in studio.
In person.
So you guys get to play. You get to watch him as he's playing. Maybe a little bit of side commentary from him there. And let me actually change this over. And I think in the lobby, you can actually just go ahead and change it over into...
The 1v1.
The nice 1v1, new custom options. Here we go.
Indeed.
All right, so that lobby number is 14165. You can hop on in, get a chance to play against Threes Up Starlight.
Got
to
use the new Mecha Asuri skin.
Oh my gosh, it's
Skyforged or regular? It's a hard choice.
Oh man, I don't know. You know, I am kind of partial to like how community colors look on that. That's pretty good.
All three of these are pretty good.
So I think we might run a few matches, and then we might give away some of those community colors. So go ahead, show them off. Show them
off.
We'll start off with community colors. And then you can switch, like, you know, every match or whatever you want.
All right, so we got... Is that German flag? Maybe?
Maybe. Maybe. I wonder if the BLR, I don't know, Belarus around there, maybe? Or Belarus, I don't know. But,
I don't know. So, ban off some of these stages.
So, yeah, stage banning, you know, for a lot of people that aren't familiar with the competitive scene, how does that usually end up working, and why does it exist?
So, the only reason why we ban stages is so no one gets forced to play on a stage they don't want to play on. Like, if you don't like the stage, but you're okay with another stage, you can ban out that stage that you're not comfortable on. So, how Brawlhalla does it is they would have... The winner, or the higher seed, would ban out every stage but three, so they can ban out all the stages that they don't like, but they leave you some stages and options. So, and after that, the loser would ban everything and leave the winner to choose out of those three that they left. So you have a lot of counterplay. Like, you know, someone doesn't like stages like King's Pass with the Shenanigans Zone, you know?
Yep. Oh,
you can leave only stages like that and ban out all the class stages, you know? So... It's a lot of tactical thinking, you know.
So you get to kind of mold the set to your play style and try and deny the opponents, even just right from that stage select screen.
So it's a competition even from stage select. Like, you don't think about these things when you're just like, it's only the fight, but stages determine so much of that fight. Like, honestly, I'll go to an example of mine. When I fought Daiku in 1v1s at Worlds, every single time that he got to ban and I got to pick a stage that I liked, I won on that stage. And every time I had to force him to, okay.
Oh, nice.
We're good.
We're clean.
But every time that he got to pick, I lost because of the stages he's comfortable on. Good edge guard. So it's pretty huge. Like, if we didn't have that option, a lot of sets would be going differently.
Wow, yeah, I mean, these are all important things that you need to consider, you need to train for. And, you know, right now you're fighting against a Val. So how do you feel about this matchup in particular versus the characters you usually like to play, Asuri?
So, people pick Val probably because of Gauntlets. Because there's not many Gauntlet characters, and there's a ton of Sword characters, so...
Right.
Gauntlets versus Katars, I feel, have a pretty good matchup.
Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh.
So, yeah, I feel like Katars really win this matchup. They have a lot of things to beat out the approaches that Gauntlets have. So that's pretty helpful. Val has really fast and weird signatures with unique properties, so that helps out a lot of Val players. Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, I noticed this fight's been hanging off stage quite a bit.
Yeah.
I mean, that's not uncommon to see, especially if somebody's playing Katars and somebody else is playing Gauntlets.
Yeah, those are the two offstage weapons that you think of, you know?
They're very good at, you know, in that offstage space, working for the edge guards. A lot of pressure, a lot of good setups. But it looks like, Logic is in here.
My boy Logic. Let's go.
All right.
This will be a fun one. But, yeah, especially for me as a person, as a player... I'm really comfortable off stage. That's where people don't want to take me, especially if I have Katars. So I try to take them off stage, because that's the only way Katars can really kill, right? They struggle with their kill options. They only have a recovery. That's the only way they can kill, and light recovery doesn't work anymore. So basically, your way to kill with guitars is to take them off stage and then try to gimp them or stare them. So that's my whole strategy with guitars, and if not, I switch off to the sword to kill.
Yeah, the sword does have very, you know, stable kill options. It's kind of a jack-of-all-trades, master-of-none weapon.
Yeah. It's good at, like, everything, but, like, not incredibly good. Like, I'd say, like, guitars or gauntlets are, like, that offstage weapon, but sword has the dare and the ground pound. Like, they can do work offstage as well.
Oof. Already, you know, just about that 30-second KO. Taking logic off the edge, and you're only in the yellow. I noticed that from the last match as well. The first stock, you usually start out very strong with a huge lead. And oh my gosh.
Please, and he's dead!
Please! How? We're not even a minute in! What is happening? Logic!
Starlight subs, put Stogimp in the chat, my new emote. Thank you.
Stogimp.
Yeah, it's like the KO effect, the default one, and then like the minus one that goes next to their name whenever you kill them. It's pretty cool.
Oh my gosh. That's great. That's great.
Oh, this man uses dodge.
Oh no! It's over! What is life? What is life?
I had to go for the cool offstage gameplay instead of getting a three stock.
Oh,
always
man.
Gotta go for
But
it.
You know what? That's what I've seen you do time and again, you know, even in these tournaments. If you're able to take someone off the edge and then get the gimp, even if you sacrifice your own stock but you have the lead, that's so worthwhile.
It's so gratifying, I guess. And I'm a person that plays for the stream, you know. Well, I play for the hype. I go off stage, I do all these cool stuff just so people have fun watching me. So in particular, the first qualifier for 1v1s at the grand finals, the very last stock I think it was, where I turned it on Remy when he was edgeguarding me.
Oh yeah.
That was pretty good.
That was crazy. I was watching that one. That was oh my gosh. That's what I love seeing, you know?
Yeah.
The hype plays, and you definitely bring them.
So I hope that I assume some of my fan base is because of, like, my hype gameplay.
Okay, yeah.
So if I play really boring, like, people aren't going to want to watch that. That's what, same thing with, like, Melee, right? Like, people don't like Hungrybox because of how he plays, and they go for, like, Fox players, you know?
Oh, yeah. So, I understand you, yeah.
Gotta play for the crowd.
So now we see you picking up and sticking with the sword here. You know, you've been playing guitars pretty much both of the past games. You really just focused on that. So is there anything about the matchup is why you're playing sword? You just want to get a bit of warm-up on that as well?
Well, there has been zero weapon spawn, so there's that. there's the first one besides that spear that he picked up. But it's mostly against spear. The spear nair is really strong against guitar approaches like bear. And I feel like sword can get in a bit easier. And I'm just trying to play a variety for the stream, you know.
Okay,
Play some both weapons. But Ada, especially with her three defense, like, she takes a lot of damage from these strings. So both of my weapons are pretty good in this matchup.
Yeah, I mean, you're already shoving her to the orange, and she's just been alive for like 8 seconds or something. That's what I've seen you do a lot of, you know, just reading people's dodges and kind of getting the punishes. We saw you carry her from the left side of the stage all the way across, and that's why she's now about to die.
Dead,
can
maybe
we seal this deal?
Aw, I read her going outwards instead of in. Oh, she used her dodge really early, though, and there it is.
Wow, again.
Yeah, my guitar play is like, I used to be just the optimal guitar player until they nerfed. You nerfed.
Oh, alright. You nerfed me.
You nerfed me, alright.
You don't need to point fingers here. I mean, you can, but sure. Yeah, sure.
So, I used to just be that player that would just, like, if I ever got an opportunity, I get the most amount of damage I possibly can. So, that would be side light, end light, recovery, and then back off. But I can't do that anymore, so I have to go for a lot of dodge reads to get any damage off. So, I'd go for down light or side light. Maybe just sometimes I'd go for an end light, or I would just dodge through them, and side light, and then wait. Because if I catch their dodge out of that, I can get a much heftier punish. And I play just so much different than how I did at BCX because of it. Where I would play like... Ooh, wait, okay.
Wow, that was really nice.
Yeah, I was waiting for her dodge up.
I always love seeing, you know, when you break that out, that side light pushes them just off stage and then you just chase into the side air.
Mm-hmm.
It looks so good and so clean.
It is, like, that's what I love about guitar is, like, off stage, if you're a stellar off stage player, you make it look so clean, so fluid.
If you actually want to hold on for a moment, and we're going to switch over since we've been showing off the community colors. We gotta get some giveaways in here. We gotta work them in. It's just active. There is no keyword. If you've just been talking in chat at all, you're in there. Staff admins, mods, we don't allow them to win these. These are codes for the community.
Indeed.
So we're going to roll some. If you had to guess what kind of name it would be. I know Dolce always goes for the B name.
We're going to go for S because Starlight.
S? Oh,
that is actually one of my subscribers, and he actually won a CC giveaway in my chat like a couple days ago.
Wow. the rigged, we need to roll again.
No!
Velocity Space HD, what? No, I've seen this guy win before. Oh my gosh, we just got to keep rolling until we get like new people. See Phantom Eagle? And, you know what, let's drop one more in there, why not? Wild Panda 12. Okay, nice. I like it. Well, we've got more coming. Those will be whispered to you after the stream has concluded.
But afterwards,
back to the gameplay here.
Gotta do the fast giveaway so we get back to the gameplay.
Yeah, that's how it goes. So, you know, a lot of people, if they've been following you for a long while, because you've had quite the tenure in this game compared to most players nowadays, they knew you as a sword player primarily.
Oh my, yeah.
So when you shifted to Katars, were there any players that you were kind of like watching, maybe internalizing some things from, picking up some tricks?
So what happened was I decided, literally the only reason why I started playing Katars is when Daiku asked me to team with him, right? I'm like, hey, I think Katars are really good in 2v2s. Like, should I try a Suri with you? Because it has a sword. And he's like, yeah, sure, try it. And I'm like, okay, so I tried a Suri. And I really just like liked the way that Katars played. I was like, these combos are cool. I like, this feels like Melee because I came from Super Smash Bros. Melee.
Yep.
It's really fast. It's really like dodge read heavy. I like this. So I stuck with them. And Daiku, of course, was remaining Ragnar at that point. So he was a Katar main as well.
Yep.
And he's literally the person that taught me everything I knew about Katars at that point. Like, Sidelight, Seraph Stage, or Infinite Loop Strings, you know, like...
Okay, yeah.
He taught me a lot of stuff, the neutral game. So my Katars come from Daiku, so...
Okay, from Daiku. So, other than learning from Daiku, did you watch any other notable players?
Not really.
Okay.
Because
I know there were a number that were popping up, I guess right before Daiku kind of made that shift to Katars as well. There was, you know, Eram and Maltimum kind of popping up and performing really well in the in the BCS series at the time.
The thing with me is I don't watch anything from EU. I only watch NA.
I only watch NA,
which is probably gonna hurt me when it comes to next BCX, but
there's plenty of time. You can do your homework.
I can do
before
my homework
then,
now.
Right?
Yeah. But I mostly stay with NA because there's this stigma that EU plays really slow and the games all take 8 minutes, and I'm like, well, I don't want to watch that then, so I stick with NA.
Okay. So you're saying NA players are a bit more volatile? Is that...
I wouldn't say
that. If you had to compare, because you played a number of international players at BCX.
Indeed, yeah.
So did you notice anything in your matches with them?
Not really. It feels the same, but just their games just go longer for some reason, so it just creates that... Wow, these players are parry. It's taking so long. They're all defensive. This is boring. So I don't know.
We can't all be defensive. He's at PAX East.
Yeah.
So
nice. But I actually got the opportunity to cast. I wanted to get into casting.
Yeah,
so
I've been seeing that.
So I casted the EU block finals. So that was pretty much my first delve into the EU scene. Basically, like I watch a bit of the tournaments when I have nothing on better to do. You know. But I got to cast the whole 4-hour block of that 32-man invitational for $500, and it was a blast. And
I
was too focused on looking at the gameplay, like analyzing things, casting to really like pay attention to like learning players. So
I know it's always a little bit different. I've noticed that, you know, in all the tournaments that I've had to cast. But now I'm curious to see, you know, we usually see a bunch of Beau from last year, and it looks like you're going to be going up against Ember here.
Indeed.
Now, you said you like Katars.
I do.
You know Katars in and out. So, how is the Beau going to play in this matchup that you're about to play?
So, there's no Beau that compares anywhere to LDZ's Beau.
And okay.
I'm sad he switched off, because that was his, like, he won Worlds with it, you know?
Yeah.
Like,
oh, yeah.
And he switches off to two completely different weapons, and it's like, his Beau consisted of reading your dodges and waiting for for that, and then hitting you with Sair. He would hit you with Sair in the neutral, right?
Yep.
And then he would jump again, because after you Sair, you're going to dodge to not get hit by a side light off the ground, right? Because if you fast fall Sair, you can hit a side light afterwards, but it's a string. But what he would do instead, he would jump, wait for your dodge to the right or left or wherever. If you dodge up, he can still hit you with a Sair because of the really lenient hitbox of it. Mm-hmm. And then he would just like hit you with four Sairs in the neutral until you're off stage, and then his amazing edgeguard skills just kill you at like yellow. So it's
brutal.
Yeah, but not many other bow players do that. They try to play the neutral game with like side lights getting damage or down light snares, and like his focus is to get you off stage because he can edgeguard.
Yep.
So no other player does it, and that's what makes bow strong, is because that Sair has such a good hitbox and it sends you in such a trajectory that you die early and you get really good gimps. But the thing about Katara is, like, people can say, oh, Katara Sair does that too, but the thing is, with Katara Sair, if you use it, you have to go into that direction, you know? Like,
yeah,
you can't
do that little
fade back Sair.
Kind of lunge forward with it, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So that makes it kind of wonky in your edge guards. You have to position yourself a lot better. Whereas bow, wherever you are, you can do a fading Sair, you can Sair into them, you could just stay in place and Sair. Like, you have a lot more options, so that's what makes Katara cool.
All right, well, let's hop in the match.
Hop into it.
See what we've got going on here.
I wonder if this guy is still here. We've been talking for like...
Oh, he is ready. He was banning this out. He's like, let's go to Shipwreck. I've got a bow. I've got Katars. Let's take this off stage.
All right. This is... I'm not going to say that. Well, everyone already knows by now, but Shipwreck's probably my favorite stage, so don't take me here. Thanks. Ooh, good string from him in the beginning. But he uses his dodge randomly. I didn't get much of a punish off of it, so we're good.
That's right. Oh, you read the dodge there. Look at that offstage string. Yes, yes. Wow.
So right there, I waited right here just like, because he only had his dodge up, and that was it. So I was like, if I just wait here for the ground pound and hit him before he gets onto that stage, or the side of the wall.
Oh my gosh.
And he's dead again.
Again! 30 seconds, two gimps.
Wow.
Man, Shipwreck is so dangerous.
So brutal. Unforgiving.
And you just know how to push the game.
Indeed. That's my strong suit. Like if I struggle in neutral games sometimes. Like most players, I will beat them in the neutral. But however, if I ever get them off stage, it's where I really shine. So their whole goal when they fight me is to try to make sure that I don't take them off stage. That was a good spot dodge right there.
Yeah, I've been seeing, you know, spot dodge, it kind of comes in and out of favor. There was a time where a lot of players were kind of using it a lot, and then they've favored a bit more, you know, diagonal dodges for a while, and then back to spot dodge. So
yeah,
I'm always curious to see when that fades back in.
Uh-huh. Spot dodging was really strong because, like, you could cancel it at any time, but then they nerfed it where you can only cancel it, like...
In the first, like, third half
of it. So it makes it a lot harder to use. You have to be predicting their approach a lot earlier to be able to use the spot dodge effectively. And what a spot dodge does is it makes your dodge go on cooldown for so long. It goes on an air dodge cooldown, so people don't like not having their dodge up.
Yeah, if you cancel it, it is that 3 second force cooldown for sure.
Definitely, and that's just really risky because dodging is basically the movement in Brawlhalla. It's how you approach, it's how you get around the map. I read him going really low to recover towards the stage, so I just followed him down with the dare. But yeah, so dodging is your main way of movement, and if you limit yourself without a dodge, you're so vulnerable for those 3 seconds that...
Oh yeah.
It's super important, so I think that's why people are just focusing more on like speed dodging now. Because out of a speed dodge, you can attack, whereas a regular dodge... I don't even know what we call those, just regular dodges?
Yep.
Slow dodge.
Just dodge. Regular dodge, normal dodge.
Yeah, you have to wait until you're fully out of the dodge animation before doing anything, so people can punish you out of that, and I think that's really what brought spot dodging off.
So, this is interesting. I haven't seen this guy around for a little
while.
Oh
my god.
Bishop. And he's using that speed stance on that Baraza. I mean, he's been playing Baraza forever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, how do you know Bishop?
So, Bishop's been a player. I think he started way before I did, actually. I started in about really late October of 2015.
Yep.
I'm trying to talk. Anyways, I think he was around... Was he in closed beta? I'm not sure.
I'm pretty sure, yeah. I remember the first time that he was actually playing the game. This is long before, you know, I became part of BMG.
Yeah.
And I was just a community member. He popped up in the Twitch chat like, oh, hey, this game looks great. I want to play it. how do I get things set up? And he was looking to set up a PlayStation controller, which is actually what I use to play the game. And so I hooked up with him in Twitch chat and set him up with, you know, the driver that I used at the time and how to set it all up and everything, and then played a bunch of matches with him. And then it kind of turned out that he was like, oh, wait, you stream, like, some of the tournaments and cast some of them and everything? So he ended up casting a tournament or two with me. Oh, my gosh, please! And you still made it back. You were just fading away with Sayers to catch all his jumps. That was crazy. That was crazy.
I gotta play for the people, man.
Holy moly.
Oh my god. He got the first stock and I wasn't having any of that, you know. I gotta put him in his place.
Oh my gosh.
But so Bishop, he's been coming to my stream a lot lately, and like we play Dead by Daylight and just like other things. Oh, like Pictionary. When I do Pictionary streams, those are fun. And that's where I know him from, but you said earlier he was using a speed stance. Now, my thoughts on stances are, I think they're okay, because they don't really do that much, like, whereas in Smash 4 you have, like, completely custom movesets with, like, their stances and stuff, and it's, like, different, but changing one stat over is pretty okay with me. And for me, I don't use any stances on Asuri, because 7 dex is about, if we look at Dobrain's list of his dexterity, how the stances affect it, Katar's and Sword are pretty good at 7. So
it's like the sweet spot.
It's like a sweet spot. Like 7 and 8 dex Sword, I'm pretty sure don't change at all. So there's that. And Katar's have like 1 or 2 frames, but 7 feels pretty good to me. So I just, because I think the dex stance takes away speed or force? I don't remember.
I'm not sure which one it takes away for her. You've got like a whole algorithm for it. But
I feel like no stance on Asuri is probably pretty good. And then like everyone's like, oh, the force stat's probably the best now because of the recent changes to the nerfs to dex and how they buff force and stuff. But I think 4 is pretty okay with her.
Okay, yeah.
Ooh. Okay, I gotta live.
Ooh. Oh. Man, oh wow. Okay.
Because he had dodge. He had no dodge.
I see what
you're
going for. Bishop!
I didn't realize that hit behind.
Yes!
Alright, we lost our first game. That's unfortunate.
Oh man. Bishop calculating everything there.
Calculated. He knows Raza in and out, so.
Oh yeah.
I didn't realize that Sig hits insanely stacked in behind.
Slamming the big explosion, yeah. It's great. And I think I saw Logic ask earlier, I actually play with the D-pad on PlayStation controller. Yeah. Analog sticks, I don't know. I've never really been too fond of them.
Mm-hmm.
So like whenever I would play, you know, Tekken, Street Fighter, and traditional fighting games.
Oh yeah, traditional fighters use that.
I use like my arcade stick, but then for some of the slower games, I end up using a pad.
Mm-hmm.
So even when I would play like Street Fighter 4, which was pretty slow by those standards, the D-pad would feel really good. But the analog stick, my thumbs, they don't understand.
We're going to go for the ladder combo here. Oh, he dodged it. He dodged it. What's he doing?
He's looking for that hammer.
Oh yeah. Fine.
He's going for it. Just pour on the damage.
Yeah. That's dodgeable now, and especially since Nair to recovery isn't true anymore on Sword, you can't really kill off of it, but I still get it sometimes, because people forget about it, and it's pretty tight as well, so that's pretty cool. But what were we talking about? I used the analog stick because I played Melee before on a GameCube controller, right?
Yep.
And there's only analog sticks on that. There's a D-pad,
it's
which
the
is
only
like...
only analog stick that I can use well.
Yeah. I wanted to use the GameCube controller for this game, but then I realized, like, I have to go through software and it's buggy, especially if you saw a Combo Breaker, how Absent had to use it. Mm. And we had a bunch of issues with him on stage with his controller, like, not working or disconnecting. So I was like, I don't want to go through that. And I think it adds extra input delay as well, so... Okay, we made it. I didn't want to hinder myself more, because I feel like that's one of the main arguments with keyboard right now. It's like, keyboard has no extra input delay, it's a keyboard. There's no pressing down to the triggers, like
right,
the
there's
specific
no soft
point.
Analog point to those, the triggers. Yeah.
And you have all your buttons laid out right in front of you, whereas like I can't do specific things. Because I have to go from like B to A or something.
Right, it's a little tougher to hit certain things in conjunction.
So that's like an argument among the top players I know, is like keyboard or controller, and everyone's switching to keyboard, but I'm gonna stay with controller.
So that's a good point. You know, I've seen that discussion time and again over the years, you know. Mm-hmm. Oh, what's better, pad, arcade stick, hitbox, like, which essentially is just a keyboard on a box.
Oh, that's so close.
Oh my gosh, get this edge guard.
What I want you BMG to do, right? My opinion. Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Make it so not having a weapon is punished more. So why I want that is because no one learns unarmed. If they're unarmed, they just run away until a weapon spawns, you know?
Mm,
so I want people to learn the unarmed kit because it's really strong, but no one utilizes it. So if you could punish not having a weapon more, then I'm pretty sure people would be forced to learn how to play unarmed, and that would bring the meta a cool way, you know? So that's my opinion.
Interesting. I know there are still a few players that kind of favor unarmed in certain matchups at certain times. But I always love seeing it, so I'm with you there that unarmed is really cool. It has a lot there that I don't know if people are utilizing to its fullest.
Exactly.
Just yet.
And this guy's clan's name is Starlight's Mom, so...
Yeah, so, you know, because I've seen, you know, some of the... There are still some pretty crazy early damage combos that I think I showed off on stream at one time, and somebody caught on to it, and they were like, whoa, wait, you can do that?
So...
Pretty much the jump in... Meaty side air, down light, immediate jump side air, gravity cancel neutral light, chase dodge neutral air.
Yeah, and I think that's still true,
yep.
Right?
Yeah, it's still undodgeable.
Yeah, the Sarah Nair is still true. That's the unarmed combo that I do now. And it's like a zero to orange, it's pretty good. It's not as strong as one thing I want to talk about, which is Sarah down light. Sare gravity cancel downlight recovery.
The old one.
So a cool thing about that is Egg Soup, me and Stevenator, and like a couple EU players are like the people who could do it consistently, right?
Right.
And people would literally take bombs, right? And they would bomb themselves, yep. So they can't get hit by it.
I remember seeing that and commentating about it because it came up more than a few times in some of the BCS tournaments I was casting back in the day.
That was an interesting time in the meta, but at that point, unarmed was really strong, but it only worked at, like, full white, I think.
Yeah.
But...
Otherwise, the side air would just push him too far for anything.
I was stacked. No, I wanted to go for the nair. I
couldn't get the full sword swipe overhead.
Oh, I think it was too high anyways. So, one thing... correct me if I'm wrong, but if I happen to hit a downlight when they're not on the ground... They'll go too high for, like right there, they'll go too high for a ledge cancel.
Yep.
Is that the only situation where that is
true?
Okay. I wanted it. I'm dead now.
Oh my gosh.
It was worth it.
Pay for the chance. And look at him, just scrolling through all four of his taunts. And one of his stocks. Just scroll through everything. But yeah, pretty much, you know, if they are higher up, You knock them up a certain distance, so that way, if you're looking for that ledge cancel follow-up, they will be slightly above.
Mm-hmm. So if that's the case, if you ever catch someone with your downlight and you're going for a ledge cancel, they're not on the ground, you can't do it, so... Ooh, here we go.
Oh my gosh!
No, he went for the turnaround, but we're good. I could still make it.
Wow, no, still held on to the stock, though, for the solid two stuff.
I had my recovery still, and I had a dodge up, so maybe I could have made it back. I'm not sure. Probably not, but it would have been close.
I mean, at that point, it was really just hanging out so that way you wouldn't die first, right?
Yeah, because that's actually something huge, right? If I was on the last stock with him there, the person who lives the longest, because we both couldn't make it back, right?
Right.
So whoever lives the longest there wins. So what Daiku told me, a good team's tactic is... To gravity cancel taunt off stage, right?
Oh, yeah.
Because it puts you in place, and if your teammate's trying to save you off stage, it puts you in place, you're easy to save, and it keeps you alive longer. So that also happens with 1v1s, where a gravity cancel taunt will keep you up long enough to where you can live longer than your opponent. So, some
nice.
Cool stuff.
I like it, those fancy strats. You know, just drop the shades on, maybe pull out the salt, just pour it off stage.
Question for you.
Yeah.
You're the technical guy, right?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
So, what taunt stays out the longest, would keep me alive the longest?
Oh, man, I can't give that info.
Can't give that info?
I know that's floating around somewhere. I know I've done tests on it. I know other people have done tests on it. We've pretty much, like, normalized all of them into a certain range. Because that was one of the concerns that came up when everyone was like, oh, gravity cancel isn't in the game now. Give us gravity cancel taunt. We want to be able to gravity cancel taunt. So we were like, you know what? That is pretty good. So when that was put in, there was a lot of work done by a bunch of the animators making sure that everything cycled through, and then also by, you know, MC 1100 making sure that everything had, like, that same window of time, so that way it wasn't like one left you out there significantly longer than all the others. And look at that recovery, just all the way under the stage.
Since I know this guy is really good with the stairs, he's gonna edgeguard that if I would have went back the other way, right? So I chose to go to the other side so I didn't have to deal with it, because Boss stage is super strong. But so I bet in the beginning when you made gravity cancel taunts, you didn't think that it would have a competitive aspect to it, like, oh, I'm gonna use this to stay alive longer.
I think it did kind of come up sooner than you would expect. Where we were just like, wait a minute, that leaves you up there for like a really long time. Could this be used for something? So it was almost immediately that people on the team were looking into it.
You caught my recovery there.
Wow. So who is this actually that we're playing as? Is this Yami Sora?
Yami Kuros.
Interesting.
See, he plays all easy bow. He hits one Sare.
I see the style in there.
He hits one Sare, right? And he'll wait for your dodge and then chase dodge into another Sare and then try to get you off stage for the edge guards. And it works really well.
So if you're saying anyone's out there looking how to play bow, oh my gosh! That was really nice. I gotta admit, you know.
Yeah, that Sig, I didn't release mine fast enough, so I think that's why it has worked.
Yeah. And you know,
that's the interesting thing about
the invulnerability frames you get from canceling a speed dodge, signatures now beat those frames.
Oh, is that live?
That went live this week. That was graduated from test features.
Okay, you should show it to me soon. And like a custom game after this.
Oh, for sure.
Because I kind of didn't really notice it or don't understand.
Yeah, it's not the actual speed dodge itself. Mm-hmm. It's when you cancel out of the speed dodge and you get those few frames of invulnerability. Mm-hmm. Those ones will get blown through by signatures.
Okay. So it's only a specific window.
Yeah. It just kind of made it a little bit more lenient since signatures win in clashes against light attacks anyway.
Yeah.
But it's definitely, you know, gave some defensive strength back to someone against someone who else is speed dodging in.
Ooh, I love fighting people.
Offstage fight, man.
I love fighting people offstage who are, like, confident enough to go up against me. It's just fun.
It makes aerial dogfights, man.
It makes this game so interesting. That's the unique thing about Brawlhalla that I really love. Is, like, if in Melee, right, if you're Falco or something, and you get thrown off stage, you die. Like, they just grab ledge and you die.
Sink like a rock.
Yeah. So this, I can go off screen to edgeguard someone, right? And still make it back. Yep. And that's amazing. I love that. It makes the game so interesting. And that's why I personally disagree with fall speed changes.
Okay, interesting.
The test feature being 15% increase of fall speed.
Yep.
Because what that does is, yeah, the game's faster. However, I can't get far enough out. I can't go as far as I could because I fall faster. So
right.
They're like, oh, but the 15% increase in speed as well, like just movement speed, and it still doesn't work that way. Like,
interesting, yeah. Because we've been cycling those out and, you know, making some tweaks and changes to them over the weeks. Pretty much we had the 15% both on the fall and the speed. And then we just kind of were like, okay, let's tweak it a little bit. We kind of normalized some of the speeds, so that way it wasn't quite such a wide range between the 2 and the 9 if you're stancing it up.
Yeah.
And then, you know, we're like, okay, well, which one is it that that players were feeling really was the benefit that they did like or they didn't like? So we've been trying, you know, the fall individually and then the speed individually to try and narrow down and nail down what it is that, you know, the players either like or dislike about those things. And I think we're getting close to having all the feedback we need on that and pulling the trigger on something. So
some hot leaks happening soon.
I mean, you know, that's kind of like the constant thing with these test features. It's some things that, you know, we've tested internally that we feel are good enough for you guys to get your hands on and try and tell us what you think. Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh.
No.
Whatever, stock for stock and you stock are up a lead. Stock, that's up. Worth. Oh my gosh. Oh, that was so close. Were you so looking close for that early gift there?
I was, because he went super low with that ground pound, so I'm like, I can maybe do something here. But
I mean, sometimes that's all it takes. You know, mm-hmm. You get hit at the wrong time.
If you catch someone out of their recovery and they don't realize it, they just die because they're like, oh, where's my recovery? I might die here.
Yep.
Nope.
That was really good patience about saving your recovery, especially all the times that he was throwing that spear down there. I know there are a lot of players that still kind of...
That was unnecessary.
This guy!
That
this
was unnecessary.
Guy, he was already dead! Please! All right, I feel bad about that one. We got to do some giveaways.
We got to do some giveaways.
I got to reward the people for that one. Oh, my gosh. Mike Swipe, what are you doing in here?
Mike Swipe.
I'm telling
That's
you.
That's a name I know.
Mike the Swipe, right? Is that? Blau Ranger.
Blau.
It's blue, except, you know, more different. More different blue. Yes.
Stimpy.
Stimpy.
The man.
I know you've already got these, right? You have to. Oh, well. He's going to give them away. He's a cool guy.
And Galley.
I see him around a lot.
Galley's one of my subs, so I'm glad he won.
Oh, sweet. I'm actually going to roll one more, because I think we've got time for one or two more matches, mm-hmm. and then we'll be rolling the big giveaway at the end.
The big giveaway?
Yeah.
What is that going to be for?
I don't know, you know?
We don't know yet?
I don't know yet. I do not know. We always do that, you know? Some mystery gift,
some sort of thing.
You figure it out.
Now I fight a Scarlet. This Ooh. Is an interesting character, and he's level 44 on Scarlet too. So there's not many Scarlet mains around. There's like
Lands? I see there are a lot of people that play her, but come tournament time, there aren't too many people that place with her.
Yeah. No, you don't taunt on me, buddy.
Oh my gosh, this guy.
See, you gotta take everything as serious as a tournament, right?
Well, you know what? I've heard a lot of, oh, he did like the opening game taunt and he didn't respect it and he hit me out of it and everything. As far as I'm concerned, you know, I'm old school with this, right?
Yeah.
Clock's ticking, fists up. Like,
exactly. That's
the bell
that's
has rung already.
That's my take. Like, I play this game to win, and if you're going to do that, I'm going to take the advantage and
try to
win.
The loading screen is your time to touch gloves if you want. Like,
exactly.
That's where you're like, all right, it's this guy? Okay, I see you. Mm-hmm. All right, nice, good game. Let's get ready. But as soon as it's like 3-2-1 brawl, it's telling you what to do.
Yeah.
That's how I feel. So, if I notice that they're trying to do it, like, I like to be nice. Ooh, nice signature.
So I realized he did a gravity canceled stomp, and he was turned around. So I had enough time to do that side signature, and it would hit pretty much like 100%.
Wow, nice. But yeah, you know, usually if I see somebody do those taunts, I want to be nice, and you know, if I catch it early enough, I'll honor it and just be like, oh hi, yeah, nice to meet you, great. But you know, if we're fighting, we're fighting.
Indeed, that's my take on it. People don't like me for it. I'm like, well, there's no reason for it. Why does taunting show respect? And when taunting is generally meant to be disrespectful, like
the greeting kind of thing. But I'm like, I'll talk to you in the post game chat.
Exactly, like it's 50-50. We're like, oh, taunts are BM or taunts are respectful, and it's like, I think taunts are disrespectful, so I never go for them. Like, what? I don't understand the purpose of it. So
I think a lot of them are just really cool.
There's
I love.
They buy them. They might as well show them off somewhere.
Like,
you know?
My favorite one that I constantly do. I know there are a lot of really cool ones. I mean, you've got the CEO Dreamland flag taunt there.
The flag taunt's amazing.
You know, I always am very partial to the ones that involve the sidekick.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why the high five one is probably still my favorite.
Oh yeah,
because I don't think it's like very disrespectful like some of the other ones. It's not like very jeering
taunt.
Or taunting, you know. It's just kind of like a nice little celebration for my team.
Yeah, your team.
I like it.
I really love the integration with the sidekicks because sidekicks aren't that really like a big part of it. You know, like they're just sitting there in the background. No one really notices them. But if you make them into a taunt, people start to realize these things. It's pretty cool. And there's this new Atlantean Ada skin, which I find is really cool, but I missed out on it. I'm going to try to go for this cool combo on this guy. All
right, right, let's see what you got. Classic Bodvar.
This is my highest level character that I stopped maining when I picked up Qataris.
I know, for you it was all Bodvar all the time before.
Right? Indeed, I never switched up. It was only Bodvar.
Oh my gosh. Ooh.
I hit that stomp stack, so it didn't really work, but.
Going for the hype plays.
The hype plays.
Oh my gosh.
Might lose though because of it.
It's alright, man. I believe.
Is this Kroki?
Is this Kroki?
Oh, it's Jazztek. This man probably takes a lot of notes from Kroki. Because Kroki is the only person I've ever seen that edgeguards with that signature. Or uses it in general, so. What is this?
Man, you were like just dodging all of those.
Alright, round two.
Nice.
This time we'll get
it. But you know, I noticed you have that CEO Dreamland flag going on.
I cannot wait
so
for that.
What is that? That's going on April 14th through 16th.
14th through 16th in Orlando. I've never been to Florida. I can't wait.
It's going to be hype. I mean, we got a ton of people going. The big names.
The big names
this,
are going to be
like,
there.
This is like, it's a double S tier event. Like, mm-hmm. There's a ton of circuit points on the line. We threw in, you know, $5,000 pot bonus there. It's crazy. So I'm hyped for it. I'm excited. You're gonna be there, right?
I'll be there, 100%.
So you're scooping up some points at Final Round this weekend, and you're gonna scoop up some points at Dreamland.
Indeed.
It's gonna put you pretty well off for the
circuit.
Pretty
well off, because there's only Noelle and I who are here, really, that are, like, circuit point contenders for, like, the top spot, so.
Oh, wow.
Like, this will put us ahead quite a bit, I think. This is a double A event, correct?
This one, I think it's... I forget if it's double or triple A.
Hmm. Either way, if it's... What are the payouts and circuit points for those?
Those ones are sitting around 80 and 120, I believe.
For first?
For, I think the total pool.
Oh, the total pool. Okay.
If I remember correctly, I've got to consult our graphic on that one. Brawlhalla.com/esports. You can get all the info there for all the upcoming events, how the circuit works, where you can watch, what's coming up, who to watch for.
Indeed. Oh, I need a nair there.
I tried to do the modified one.
Yeah,
I
didn't
it.
Realize that he was so high, or else I would have naired. I don't even think the nair would work.
Ooh, yes. Catch him with the top of the swing.
The top of the swing that should not be that lenient of a hitbox.
Oh man.
Oh, I still got the stomp side stick at the end, so we're good. I miss the stairs.
Close.
But yeah, this is Hammer Sarah is a super huge hitbox. I don't think it matches the animation, so.
Ooh, well, that was like super right risky. On the animation. It starts low and then massive swing. Massive swing. I think
massive
I went off
is
camera
not,
with it actually.
Massive is definitely a not an understatement, so.
I'll get everywhere. All right. I think we actually have to go over to the big giveaway now.
The big giveaway.
That's what we're looking for. So, thank you for playing, everybody. You got a chance to play mm-hmm. against Starlight, give him some warm-up for the tournament this
Indeed.
Weekend.
Indeed. Thank you,
He's
guys.
He's going to be playing. We're going to be talking about that. But there's also a lot of stuff going on at PAX East up in Boston. So, keep an eye on twitter.com/Brawlhalla. You can tweet us there, let us know what's going on, what you guys are doing. I know they're doing another play a dev. How many stocks can you take? How many stocks can we take? Same thing that we did at PAX South. Mm-hmm. We're now doing it at PAX East.
And the results are not what you would expect.
You know, I've got a message for the guys up there. You need to step it up.
Step it
I saw,
up, BMG.
I think I saw Chill Penguin send me a message. You know, we had taken 11 stocks. The community, PAX, had already taken 6 stocks. And won a game.
And won a game. Did they even win one game?
I think at
PAX?
At PAX, they actually won, I believe, 7 games.
7 games the whole weekend, but they just started 11 stocks in, and they already won one.
We took like 1,300-something stocks at PAX South. Come on, guys. Don't let me down. And if you are at PAX East, go play dev. Try and win some
Definitely.
Prizes. Try and up your score there. That's always hype. I know there's... You know, the PAX South avatar that's now in there commemorating mm-hmm. how many stocks they took. But that's not the only in-game stuff that we
Indeed.
Have. And I think we're actually going to be giving away some in-game stuff right now.
Right now.
All latch giveaway. Here we go. This is Latch giveaway tool. It's made by Latch from Berserk Studios. There he is. He streams. He develops. He develops while he streams. He streams while he develops. He makes this tool, which is just super awesome that anybody can use, give stuff away. It's really cool. Has a really some really nice features, which is what lets us do this. Just go boom, add viewers, load them in from the channel.
Load them in, and we're good.
And you're already there. No keywords. Just everyone already in chat. Beautiful. And how we work it this time, we're giving away...
I don't know. Mystery. We'll figure it out later.
Mystery gift. Starlight, please. Mystery gift, Starlight, please. So, there will be something given away. You will get community colors and some sort of in-game item. Who knows what it might be? We'll figure that out
later.
But if a subscriber or a mod wins, we're actually going to give away two things. Yeah, we roll it again. It's crazy.
And if three's up, Starlight wins, which I won't because I'm not in the chat. Giveaway three.
Oh my gosh. I see what you did there. I see what you did. I was rolling.
Gotta give him false Starlight hope because I'm not in the chat.
Starlight,
please in the chat.
All right, so let's find out what's going to be. Are you going with an S name again?
S. We gotta, I'm going to
believe in
S.
The Dolce. You know what? He hasn't steered me wrong yet. He's usually right. It's a B name. It's got to be a B name. I don't know how many B names are in chat. I should probably look at that. Game the system.
You got to have statistics.
Oh, there's DJ Tech Live. Wow. Shark Bear.
We're right. Let's go.
Oh my gosh.
Let's go.
All right, Starlight. Let's see.
Easy reads.
Well, you know what? First, we got to see if he's actually here, though. He just has to speak up in chat, let us know, and then he can win his item. So let's find out. Is he here? Is Shark Bear here?
Speak up if you would like your mystery gift.
Let's find out.
And oh! There he is.
Well, nice. Yeah, that's what I said.
And Latch's giveaway tool automatically does that, doesn't it?
I love these features, man.
I didn't realize. I thought you had to click
something. That's how it used to be. But then, you know, Latch was just like, you know what would be really cool that a lot of people were looking for? An easier way to find winners. There you go. So, Shark Bear, congratulations. You won some community colors and some mystery in-game item that will be whispered to you after the stream.
After the stream.
Yeah, indeed. So thank you, everybody, for hanging out, playing Starlight, talking. Thank you for coming by, sitting for these interview questions.
Such an amazing experience. I get to see all the leaks that I can't talk about. I get to see how you guys do stuff, and it was pretty cool.
Yeah, you spent a bunch of time with the art team.
Because
really cool.
I'm going to be an animator, so maybe I'll work here after I'm done with my competing days. Once I get washed up, you know,
I'll stack up enough trophies to fill up your desk. You'll look to place them on the desk here. I see. All right. Well, we'll see how this weekend goes.
We'll see how this weekend goes. This will be the determining factor of if I retire early or not.
Well, good luck. I'm excited to watch you play. We will be recording matches and everything, so that way you guys will get to see it.
So, right now, is there going to be a stream for final round?
There is no live stream, but there will be footage that we will upload.
So, it will be uploaded later. Maybe it will be replayed on Brawlhalla's Twitch channel in the future as, like, a weekend where nothing's really going on, maybe.
Yeah, we could possibly rebroadcast, but it'll definitely be on the YouTube at the very least, so that way everyone can watch these hype matches. You're looking to fight Noelle.
Probably.
We'll see how that shakes out.
We'll see what happens.
I'm excited. All right, well, thank you, everybody, and have a great weekend. Follow us at PAX. Keep an eye on the Twitter. If you're at PAX, come hang out, see us. We got some cool stuff.
Buy the salute taunt.
Yes.
Buy the salute taunt. Support.
All right. Bye.